and keeping track of everything on the go. The future of money is simple, and it's here. Download the new M-Pesa app today.
And a very warm welcome. March 2020 is when the first COVID-19 case was reported in Kenya. And now, over 1 year, 6 months later, masks, sanitizers, still among the most purchased items in the market. What most Kenyans are now most aware of is their average temperature at 36 degrees Celsius, for most of them at least. And with the surge of cases, different sectors were adversely affected. Today, we want to find out what the situation is economically and socially speaking. Welcome to The Big Idea and our big question of the day. What is your new normal? With me on set, right next to me, is Peterson Mwangi, insurance manager. Karibu sana.
Asante. Okay. Thank you so much, okay. Nadima.
Karibu. And Angela Nzilani, who is a life coach.
Thank you.
Welcome, lady and gentlemen, and let's have this conversation. Yeah. So COVID, I know COVID is one of those topics. When you're anywhere, you can just start talking with someone. Those conversations, yeah. Say COVID on onaji. Itaisha. I know it's that conversation that we have all the time. And we've been in this situation for the last 1 year, 6 months now. At the onset, very many things changed. Very many industries, tourism industry, even the insurance industry. All these sectors were affected. But now we're living with the pandemic. We're still in it. We're living with COVID-19. And people have had to adjust. So maybe if I can just pick your brain, Peterson, as we begin at the onset of the COVID-19 and up to now. I know this is a long time, but how business was for you in the insurance sector, and maybe what you are doing to resuscitate.
Yeah, thank you so much, Lima. No, to me, in fact, it was totally surprising me that it is 1 year, 6 months. We thought Corona, like, have been here for almost like 3 years.
It has felt that long.
Yes, it has, you know, we feel like it has been so long. Months are taking ages to end. And I would say that, for sure, business have not been easy. Even in insurance industries, business, it is not easy at all. Understanding that, like what you said last time, that insurance, it is one of the hardest business
to sell insurance.
So I don't know if maybe you've ever tried to.
I've seen people try and I'm like, whoa.
So I think then I should maybe recruit you to come and try, mm-hmm. do something in the insurance. But for sure, COVID-19 has really affected not only the insurance industry, but also economically in the country. Kenya have totally been affected. Mm-hmm. I was looking at a certain article where it says that Kenya has the highest number of COVID-19 in East Africa. Mm-hmm. So noting that, that means that there is a certain number of people who are working in the insurance who have been affected. There is a certain number of people who have been my client who have been affected. That tells you automatically my business will go down. So now the question is, what are we doing to make sure that the business will not go down?
Yeah. Okay, so, and before we even come to that,
yes.
I will bring you, Angela, and you are a life coach. Mm-hmm. At the onset of the COVID-19, I know we've had the conversation of COVID-19 and how people are just trying to adjust. So did that affect your trade as at that time, at the onset?
Yes, it did. And I can say for me, I think it affected positively, mm-hmm. for my business, mm-hmm. because I was quick to adapt the online coaching, and I realized that people are embracing online coaching because now they didn't know where to go. They had, you know, businesses are closed and some have lost jobs. They also want to be coached. They want to talk to someone, and now they have the time. And for me, I think people opened up more into social media and, you know, the gadgets. So it was easy to set up a meeting on WhatsApp video call with someone, or just a WhatsApp normal call, voice call. or Zoom, and I was able to reach out to even people from other parts of the world, unlike now before COVID when we were just moving, going to the places where the people are.
Mm-hmm.
So I think it affected positively as well as also negatively in the sense of the overwhelm, because too much of course, of these gadgets, it's not good,
yeah.
It's not healthy.
Mm-hmm.
For me, it turned out to be a very unhealthy thing, and I came to realize that things are really getting out of hand. I'm getting stressed up because I'm indoors, I'm sitting, and I'm not even exercising as much as I should. And I think it had to take a lot of awareness for me to jump up and start embracing it differently.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So then from what you're saying, I get that a lot of Kenyans are now open to getting professional help.
Yes, yes they are. Mm-hmm. And one thing I must commend people is that some are even coming out even when you know you don't have like the money to pay, but you still want to talk to someone. And somebody who is out there to help or to serve, like if you're doing it for serve, like your purpose, you can't just say no to somebody. You'll figure out a way of working together.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so I've seen that Kenyans are really now embracing more of positive thinking and talking to someone for help, because
mm-hmm.
now they relate with others. They have seen the stories. So they relate that with others who have gone through similar stories.
Mm-hmm.
So they want to engage.
Okay.
Yeah.
So would say your nature of work, you're the gainers of this pandemic.
I wouldn't say gainers, really. I would say, because it's gaining, but also it's more of service.
Yeah.
You've been sent to serve, so you can't say no when you've been called to serve. It's like when doctors now, they've really been engaged so much in their work, line of work, more than ever before. So they have to, what is that called? Send themselves.
Mm-hmm.
So we also have to send ourselves to make sure that, or to try and even serve more, even if it means going online and doing some videos just for free, because you cannot, if you have some time and you know that people need your services, you just get out there and serve.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Okay. And there were job cuts across different industries. And speaking of insurance, did any job cuts affect maybe people around you?
Yeah. You know, Nelima, when something which is something, let us call it pandemic,
mm-hmm.
may it be maybe something like a war or something has happened, you come to realize that something has happened. And I remember one of my friends we were sharing, and he told me that in where they work in a bank, they were told that if your work collides with another person's job, count yourself
out.
So most of them, they decided to fire themselves and they left. Even to other companies, you notice that if your work maybe collides, maybe this person is a secretary and the other person, maybe the job is maybe printing the papers, all that. Maybe your job collides with the other person. So what will happen? Instead of maybe to ukato mshara, what will happen? You are out of work. So it has happened. And that has really affected us so much. This being, those people who are being fired, remember, they are our customers. They are our clients. That tells you, I'm also now struggling. Because the client that I had put my hope in, the client who was paying me, the client who was paying my rent, who was fueling my car, that person is not employed again. So what am I supposed to do now to start? How am I going to help my client, my customer or my client? It has been there. That have been a very big challenge. Very many people currently in the country, they are really crying. Even you look, even not only in the insurance industry, even in the hotel industry, you notice that very many people now they are unemployed. currently as we are speaking.
Okay, and you know, very many sectors are now trying to resuscitate after this whole period, and it's a bit uncertain, so we're not very sure what the next 2 years look like. But we have to get on with life anyway.
Yes.
And make money and provide even for the basics. So in the insurance sector, what would you say is the approach that maybe your specific company has taken in order to survive this pandemic?
First of all, when this happened, people, now, I don't want to say they're friendly to the insurance, people all to the insurance, but people happen to be like, they have been opened. You see, people have like been reborn. They've started, the mindset of people, even the society, even to the world, the insurance is totally now different. I don't want to say like Angela, they've benefited out of this. The matter is that people have totally now come to the realization that insurance was very much important. It was very vital even to their life and to even the life of sibling. Because someone said, if you really love the people who are close to you, then you don't think of you don't think of how much you can benefit yourself, but you think how you can benefit your people. So when you take an insurance, you notice that you're benefiting the people who are your siblings or maybe your beneficiaries. Because if someone happens, now allow me say this, if someone happens to get sick and test COVID, test positive, if this person had a cover, the bill will be sorted. Is that true? Mm-hmm. But what if the person didn't have a cover? The burden will
becomes
go.
Becomes the problem of the family.
Now that is double burden. Because we have COVID, there is no money, there is financial instability, you seek, you need money, you can count all that. But now, where we've what we've done as insurance, we've tried now to focus, either some of the insurance have decided to reduce some premium, maybe the premium, the minimum premium was 10,000, they decided to reduce so that mwananchi wa kawaida can be able to save or can be able to buy insurance. On medical cases, they have also decided at least to reduce the covers, to revise the covers. I was checking another article where now you can have a cover even 240 inpatient. So they've revised that cover. With only maybe something like 16,000, you have an inpatient of maybe 500, 1 million. So that that revision of that of the insurance have at least given people an opportunity to be covered. So that was one. The other thing, we've now gone to the social media. We came to realize that almost 80% of Kenyan, they're on social media. Either TV station or maybe the, let's talk of social media, because social media is totally very wide. Eh?
People are on Facebook.
Yeah, people on Facebook, Twitter, and those people, they happen to be having a lot of money. Nalima, if I can be online for 6 hours, that tells you I'm capable.
Maybe it's an addiction.
Yeah? No, not even an addiction. That tells you how many, my friend. Yeah? That is your happening. So if this person can be online and automatically I'm checking now, this person is on Facebook, this person is on WhatsApp. So this person happens to be having at least some coins, because that mama who is in rural area, they automatically at a time they are not able even to afford the credit, Safaricom or Airtel, even if it is 20 shillings. So what about this person who is able to afford bundles to for all that period? Mm-hmm. That person is very much stable. So we've gone ahead looking for those people, because we know, because they're educated, the social media has already educated them. Those are the best now customers.
Mm-hmm. So this means that the EU insurance people are alive to the fact that there is an eventuality even of potential pandemics. We hope not, but now we have to stay prepared. So is that why you have reduced some of the premiums? Just COVID-19 being a lesson?
Automatically, first of all, allow me to say this, that after every few years, there's always a revision which will be done in most of the companies. even when maybe people like, maybe the people who are selling maybe, let's say maybe something like, maybe like rice, automatically the companies, after a period of time, they will revise because of maybe something like inflation. Now, the same thing happens to the insurance industries. They automatically revise depending on what is happening in the society. Now, the visuality that maybe something might come or might happen, that might be one of the reasons why this has happened. The reduction of the premium and all that.
Okay.
Yeah.
And Angela, so this is the new normal. You know, people are like, when is life going to get back to normal? And we are being told, this is the new normal. Now get used to it.
Yeah.
So how do people adjust? I know there's a lot of adjusting that has had to be done. At the onset, people were home more than they used to be, and we cannot go to social places as much anymore. And moving forward, we know that there are new things that we have to embrace as we go on. But even in so doing, then how can people then completely adjust themselves to now, there is no going back to normal, this is the new normal?
First of all, you know, COVID has come to really communicate the need for adaptability. And it's something that was, it's a skill that even before COVID, it was very important. But now it's even more important because it's required for everyone, whether you're working or not, whether you're in business or not, whether you're a leader or not, you still have to be adaptable. So you need to, people need to really embrace the new way of living, because now it's like we have become used to wearing masks. It was even helping during the cold season, actually.
Yeah, you know? And on motorbikes, all the wind.
Yes,
it covers.
Yeah, it covers, and you're not breathing that cold air. Yeah. And that's a way of adapting. But we need also to adapt new ways of thinking, new ways of doing things. We need to learn new skills. You know, if it is like social media, why are you, instead of just being on social media and you're communicating with friends and you're checking out who is doing what and what, how they're living their lives, why don't you convert that time into something useful? Something, instead of calling it maybe like social media, you can call it business media. Mm-hmm. So you redefine it and you adapt into doing something different. Or something, you can't just say that because I was fired, let me just stay at home. I've seen people who lost their jobs in January, when COVID came, and by now they already have thriving, maybe YouTube channels, and they're making a lot of money.
You have a lot of stars from social media during this time, yeah?
Yeah, people have cropped up. People have developed new skills that they never knew that they would have. People have they've also become media people.
Mm-hmm. And then we have chefs.
Yes.
Yeah. And then we have everybody working out.
Yeah, so we have to be...
Even teachers.
Yeah, teachers, yeah, true. Yeah, yeah, so a lot has cropped up, and people just need to embrace that fact that they are powerful enough to, you know, to create, because we were born creators. We are created in the image of God. God is the creator. So same thing with us, we can also create. So we have to embrace our creative nature and embrace new ways of doing things, things that are beneficial to us, not just something that is not useful to you. So whatever somebody is doing, let them ask themselves, how is it beneficial to me? How is it helping me? So we need to be able to, when I say positive thinking, sit down with yourself and ask yourself, how did I spend my day? Out of these 6 hours I spent on social media, what did I gain from it? And what can I do to convert this time into something positive? Yeah.
Okay. And even as we say, this is the new normal. For a lot of people, then they would ask for, in your line of work, does it affect the face-to-face interaction? You know, we always say there's a place for that personal appeal. Like, so I go to Angela and I'm going through something and I just need guidance. And there's the Zoom, there's WhatsApp video call, but there's always the personal appeal. So does it affect your trading that way? Are people getting the help in their best way?
Of course, I get people who say, no, I want the face-to-face sitting. And we have that allowance also. We can communicate. We can do that. We can do the coaching that way. But what about when you're dealing with someone who is, let's say, in America? How would you, you can't pay a flight to go there every other time you have a session. So you just need to see we accept that this is what we have right now. So if we accept, once you accept something, it becomes easy for you to, you know, to work with. So we need to just, that's now the adaptability, knowing that this is what I have available for me, so how can I make good use of it? So if I'm coaching someone and they still insist on face-to-face, we assess their, you know, how expensive is it going to be for us to meet physically? How is it going to be a cost to the client? Is the client willing to pay that cost? Or... you know, how willing are we to get exposed to, you know, sitting out in, yeah, maybe in a place or even in an office? So we need to, people just need to be at a place where you can assess what you have, you see what you have around you, what is at your disposal, and then you can use that for your own good, but you have, of course, to assess and see whether it's good.
And would you say then that social media was your way of adapting how your business was affected, and now that was your adaptability move?
Yes, I can say it was. I converted it into business media instead of social media. I don't just post to be seen. I post with a meaning. And I go there, when I look at people's posts, I look at what am I learning? What is this person doing that is positive or of help to me? So I don't just go to social media for the, you know, she's looking so...
Yeah, smart. Long hair, don't care.
Yes. Yeah, so now I have to be very deliberate with what I do. Because I know time is of essence, and social media is very addictive, like you said. We get addicted very fast. So, and once you get addicted to social media, you start getting, you wonder, why do I feel the way I'm feeling? I'm feeling depressed, I'm feeling stressed up, and I don't know why. But it's just that addiction. There may not be other underlying things, but social media is classified as the most addictive thing. You know, for people, the most addictive, even beyond drugs.
And it cuts across ages.
Yes.
It's addictive for babies, for teenagers, for older people.
Yeah, yeah. So we have to, I saw something about a post, a very funny post about a child when they're in the house, they're in control of the remote. And you wonder, how can something so small be so much powerful, yeah, that we can't even watch news, but the kid is there with the remote and they can't let it go? That's addiction. So we have to also be very careful with our children.
Yeah. I hate the kids who decide if there's gonna be news watched on that day. Yes. Like, why didn't you watch news? Yeah, my kids were watching Paw Patrol or something. Yeah. I wanted to talk about the social aspect, how we've had to change the way we interact. But I'll be taking that. I do understand we have to take a very short break. This is The Big Idea. What is your new normal? Talk to me. The SMS number is 20374 at Look Up TV on Twitter, Look Up TV on Facebook. Don't go too far.
The future of money is simple. Like unlocking possibilities with a smile. And having the world in the palm of your hand. It's the ability to touch many lives at the same time and turn your dreams into reality. It's forgetting and still remembering. Simple is having everything that you love in one place. From the ticket to your next meal, to your ticket to the next holiday. It's an easy way to ask for a boost when you're low. And keeping track of everything on the go. The future of money is simple, and it's here. Download the new M-Pesa app today. Career Guide.
Never feel like you are stuck. No matter how careful you are about choosing the right career or job, someday you may want to make a change. You will probably be able to come up with a bunch of reasons not to do it because change is scary, but consider it anyway. Take this saying to heart. If you don't like where you are, move. You are not a tree.
Career Guide.
To grow your business, broadcast your sermon, share birthday wishes, make funeral announcements, produce adverts and documentaries, then book and advertise with us today by calling us on +254 700 893 542.
700 893 542.
Or email us on sales@luke-up.tv.
Health Check. In association with
Natural Juicing Center.
Why avoid self-medication? Potential risks of self-medication practices include incorrect self-diagnosis, delays in seeking medical advice when needed, infrequent but severe adverse reactions, dangerous drug interactions, incorrect manner of administration, incorrect dosage, incorrect choice of therapy, masking of a severe disease, and risk of dependence and abuse. Always seek medical advice from a certified health practitioner.
Health Check, in association with
Natural Juicing Center. You can now book for any service or order for food supplements on our website www.naturaljuicingcenter.co.ke. You can also visit our center in Kahawasukari, house number 1334, Kahawasukari Avenue. Natural Juicing Center. Your health is your wealth.
Like, follow, subscribe, click the notification button. Join the Look Up TV movement now. Now.
Please make those payments and take dinner out the freezer. Enjoy your day off. Your day.
Great.
Did you pay the bills?
Abby did it.
And the plumber?
Abby did it.
Send money to
Abby
your mom?
Abby did it.
Who's Abby?
Bank on WhatsApp with Abby, your 24/7 digital personal banker. Another digital innovation that gets things done. That's Africanacity. That's Absa.
Did you take dinner out the freezer?
And welcome back. Thank you so much for staying with Look Up TV. The hashtag is Big Idea. The big question we are asking you today is, what's your new normal? 1 year, 6 months down the line, we're still in the midst of the COVID-19 pandemic. But what is your idea of normalcy right now? Nancy Lima here, and breaking down this topic today, right next to me is Peterson Mwangi, insurance manager, and Angela Nzilani, life coach. And now, let's continue the conversation. So, Kenyans are social people. Kenyans love to interact. They love to party and have fun. But now with the pandemic, of course, that was greatly limited. And are we seeing then a scenario where we're going to be secluded individuals, Angela? Is that going to be a possibility that we are very social people, but we could be loners? Because now we don't get out as much.
Yeah, but getting out doesn't mean that you're not socializing. Mm-hmm. I mean, not getting out doesn't mean that you're not socializing, because you can connect with people online, on video call. You can connect with people on phone. You know, yes, we miss the touch. And mostly war and to those who are single, and we miss that. we miss the connection, you know, the physical connection, the touch, the hugging, you know, and all those things. But like I said before, we just need to understand that this is what we have right now. Maybe things will change, maybe with the vaccinations or maybe a drug will come up. But we just have to embrace the fact that, yes, we are social beings, but it is my responsibility to connect with people. Everyone has to play the role of knowing that I am responsible for my own life. So how can I get out and be careful? Like the way we are here, it's during the pandemic, but we are social distancing. And once we get out of here, we wear our masks. And so that part has been sorted. It has to be our own personal responsibility for each one of us. So I think yes, it is affected to some extent, but we still can be able to interact and connect with people.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And a lot of jobs had employees working from home. And that, again, limits interaction, because there's something about going to work and interacting with people, going for lunch, tea break, and what have you. So do you feel like the working from home, again, affects that interaction bit adversely?
Yes, and thanks so much, Nalima. Automatically, it has really affected. Even in our industry, automatically we've really been affected. And I was just remembering when you were talking with Angela, a moment where we were supposed to celebrate, but it was not possible since there is no one to celebrate with. We were just five of you, we're just two of you, and automatically maybe you've done something good. Maybe there was someone who was supposed to be congratulated, appreciated, but those people, they are not there. Even if you hold a meeting online and you want to like celebrate, other people, they are still sleeping when you're having a meeting. Mm-hmm. You tell them, can you open your videos? No, my video is not working. So the only thing that...
Turn on your mic.
Yes. So all that. But in fact, Kenyans, they are totally very good in socializing. I remember when people used to be called for parties, even the meetings, you find there's a certain alive. The meeting, that meeting is live. Mm-hmm. Now here you're just talking alone, I was not used to. I'm holding a meeting, at a point I feel like, am I talking to myself? So let me check, hi, can you be able to hear me? You know, all that. Mm-hmm. So these pandemic has totally affected our social life. Even in companies, even the way we used to live, I was just also thinking of a certain Mheshimiwa, a friend of mine, who happened to be having a birthday today, but bad enough, that birthday cannot take place because of what? COVID-19. So I can imagine the way celebration would have been, the way people have known, would have wished to be together, join hands together, pray for Mheshimiwa, aishi miaka mingi. But now, tutamwambia tu kwa happy birthday. But someone said, the moment you sit with someone and talk with someone one-on-one, you happen to know that person more better. If you're working in a certain company, if you're not meeting these people, maybe even another person, a new person have been introduced to a company, but you've not met, you're not talking, you will never know that person. You will never know how to handle that person. Until that person comes closer to you. Like what Angela was telling me, I remember even when I was in school, there came a moment when I needed to sit with my teacher one-on-one. That Mwalimu, let's agree on this. Either we agree or disagree. Mimi nitoke shule, I go. But If you're talking online, someone can pretend. Even the way Angela was saying.
So there is that risk.
Yes, there is that risk of am I going to be left alone? Will I find one day maybe I'm just doing my things alone? My friends are nowhere to be found, nowhere to be seen. Mm-hmm. There's that risk.
Okay. And Angela, of course, COVID-19 exposed a lot of weaknesses and weak areas. We're not even in the education sector, the poor infrastructure. There are so many things that were exposed. So we were just brought to the reality of things. So what about us as Kenyans, as our skills, socialization skills, communication skills? Are these things we need to work on better moving forward?
Yeah, we really have to be deliberate in working on ourselves and making sure that we connect even much better. I think for maybe taking my own example, I think I have, because of working from home a lot, there comes a time when I look back and I see that my usual friends, the ones that I used to know before, we are not connecting, as before. We are not meeting as before. We are not even calling each other like before, because now everyone is minding their business. Mm-hmm. There's no chance for us meeting, or the chances are very few. So you realize that you have to really be deliberate. I have to really plan and put it on my diary. I'm going to call so-and-so at this time. Or I'm going to just make it deliberate that it is my responsibility to get out there and connect with other people, because it's normal. We are social beings. You cannot live alone. You can't live like an island, whether there's COVID or not. You still want someone either to suffer with or someone to, to connect with. You want familiarity. And as much as I say I'm connecting with clients who sometimes turn out to be friends or who also maybe not, I still want those who know me better, those who connected with me more, family members and relatives. So I think it's just a personal decision, responsibility for everyone to take that initiative.
Mm-hmm. So we have to be very intentional.
Yeah, we have to be intentional with that.
And during this time of the COVID-19 pandemic, the number of cases of anxiety and depression, the leading in the mental illness in Kenya right now. Yeah. And being that that's your area of expertise, have you had an increasing number of people with these specific conditions?
Yes, actually, mm-hmm. suicidal cases are growing. Yeah. People with anger issues. I get calls with maybe someone would tell me that she gets angry very often and she doesn't know why, over nothing, over people that she shouldn't even be arguing with, like what you are Luthi, or someone has made a delivery and just made a small mistake and you're there sparking. And all these are signs of stress and depression. And the lack of socializing is one of the causes, and also now this social media, being so much on social media, the addiction, and also we have just staying alone. When you take too much time alone, you tend to collapse or to shrink your mind in a way. So it's good to just get out there for people to, people need to get out there, because the cases are really rising and it's alarming. Sometimes I get faced by situations. Someone was just about to commit suicide. Their wives are calling me, or even themselves want to just share what they are going through, or women, the same thing. And it's all about the frustrations of what is going on around us. You get sick and you've been fired. And whether it's COVID or not, you've been fired because you're the easier one to lay off. Mm-hmm. So how do you help yourself? So this now drives people into getting even more depressed. So we need to just be aware of what is surrounding us, what we have around us. So how can we change the situation? So how do we adapt into what has happened to us now? If I was fired because I was sick, how can I help myself to be able to, you know, to pull through? And one of the best ways to pull through is just embracing a positive mindset, getting to understand who you are. Who are you? Mm-hmm. And one of the deep things that can really heal all this is getting to understand who you are first before, because you need to sit down, to be able to sit down with yourself and ask yourself, if Nelima is stripped of her job, you know, you're stripped of your job, your status, mm-hmm. maybe you're a mother, you're stripped of all that, you're a wife, you're stripped of all that, you're stripped of everything you own, who are you? So you need to be able to discover who you are first, because that is where self-confidence, self-esteem will come from.
Okay.
Yeah, to be the big able question, to embrace new skills.
And the big question we are asking you today, what's your idea of normalcy? How are you adjusting at your workplace, school, and whichever the place that is? And Mwangi, yes. Now that things are different, people have lost jobs, people are trying just to adjust, get on to doing businesses. But then so for you, maybe I just ask you, socially, how have you adjusted?
On my side? To me, at first it was a very big challenge. And I believe automatically, allow me also say this before I answer that the moment that the country or the lockdown was brought down, there was a very big problem that happened. Because each and every person was like a calf. Dama amefunguliwa, and they want to run.
And that freedom.
Freedom. They used to say freedom is coming tomorrow. Mm. Yeah? So that is what happened. Because of that, now freedom. Everybody was everywhere. And that is what led to Mombasa and Nairobi being one of the counties with the highest number of COVID-19. But now, that has reduced after people saw that this was serious. And to me, like on my side, things changed automatically. Automatically, I have not been going in gathering. And I'm still trying my level best to make sure that I'm reducing my movement, even in the county, or even maybe outside the country. So automatically, I myself have totally been affected. Mm-hmm. Because most of the time you need to be in the house, meeting, you're working from home, everything you're working from home. But now the biggest challenge, like on my side, it is how you can sell insurance.
When you're seated in the house.
When you're seated in the house.
That's a hard one.
Yes. When you understand that even when you're talking to this person one-on-one, this person still brings objection. Like, can we do this tomorrow? Now, how many people do you think they have time to just sit down and then you explain to them when you are just online? A very small percentage, maybe 10%. But now, on the other side, when it was now one-on-one, it was more easier for me because I'll just call you and come here, Nelima, kindly, after you've maybe talk across studio, can I meet you for 5 minutes? And you say, 5 minutes? 5 minutes, it is fine. So I'll come take your 20 minutes. And in the meantime, I have closed the business.
Close the deal.
Yes, automatically I've closed the deal. So only to realize that you said 5 minutes, but you spent 20 minutes. That's how one-on-one interaction also, it was more important.
Okay, and loss is one thing that a lot of us have gone through. At first, we didn't know anyone who has COVID or who's died of COVID, but I believe by now, we have a relative, a friend, a colleague who's suffered from the illness or has even lost their lives due to the same. So when people are dealing with loss, Angela, during this time, and you see again the uncertainty that is lacking. So we do not know who's getting sick. So there's that uncertainty and at the same time dealing with loss.
Yeah, now we need to take life a day at a time. You know, planning short, you know, in short term. Because, yes, dealing with grief is real, but we also need to understand that it's inevitable, that everyone will go. However, maybe they are going more now, but it's inevitable. So everyone will get to a point where they will go. So I remember, this story. My grandmother stayed until she was about 110. And when she heard a neighbor has died, she would cry and ask God, why have you forgotten me?
Why not me?
why are you not taking me? But now things are really real, you know. We are facing it. We are seeing it. It's happening. And people are now coming to embrace the fact that, you know, it might happen to me too. So we need also to just know that you're not here forever. You're not here forever. So what are you doing to make a change in your life or in somebody else's life? What are you doing how can you embrace new things to be able to make yourself useful? So that way, then we need now to plan our lives. You need to be able to plan for your life. Don't plan from A to Z, plan from A to B. When you see A to B has worked, it becomes easy for you to plan for B to C and C to D. But if you plan for Z, and you see that the journey is too long, I don't know whether I will really achieve this, I might even die along the way, then you... You just relax.
So again, just change how we set the goals.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
And let's talk about children even as we conclude. Children, Angela, you have children.
Yes.
And how has it been adjusting? We know that children and then the pandemic, they want to go out, they want to have fun, they want to go out for lunch, be in the bouncing castle, and they still have to have their mask on. They go to school, and they still have to have their mask on. So it's even harder for them than it is for adults.
And actually, I will differ with you there. Mm-hmm. It is easier for children to adapt than adults. Yes, we know the meaning, but when we teach children, because they have bigger brains than ourselves, their brains are untapped.
So they even take precaution better?
Yeah, they do. I remember I have my son is 6 years old, and when they opened school, you know, at home we are just lazy parents sometimes, and myself included. But when they opened school, you see him now washing the way we were taught how to wash when COVID happened. You know, the way they were saying, wash your fingers like this. Up to today, he does it that way. He wears his masks and makes sure that it's covering to the nose. Mm. So they know. Now the children, it becomes very easy. We were very worried when schools opened about, hey, how are these babies going to, you know, to manage this? When they come home, you know, they are so dirty and there. But I think there's a lot of grace that the teachers have that, I don't know, they're just graceful people. They're blessed. Because the way they train these children to come home, I mean to be able to interact with each other, still wearing their masks, and they are able to sanitize, they're able to embrace the new ways of living. When you tell them, don't go to this place, remember there's COVID, you see them masking. You see them, and it's all about just knowing that they too can adapt.
Okay.
They too can be able to adapt to the new ways of living. So it's up to us now to teach them. Yeah.
Yeah, Mwangi, what about the parenting aspect?
To me, I don't know. Now, I would support Angela or I support you, but... because Angela automatically has divided with you. But to me, I've been watching kids. When they're going for bouncing council, they're going to some. There's a time I was in City Market. Is it City Market or is it City Park?
Mm-hmm.
Yes, City Park. There was a moment I was in City Park, and I noted that most of the kids, they just put off their mask. But the moment that kid removes the mask, they're going to leave the mask where it is. First of all, let me go play, then I'll come back. You notice that for a kid, even if you give a kid maybe a jacket, a kid can leave a jacket anywhere or anyhow. So they will just leave their mask, go play, thinking that when I'm playing, there's no any COVID-19 interaction. But at least when I'm going to school, I'll put up on my mask. When I'm going for maybe for child service, I'll put on my mask. Mm-hmm. So at least the kids, they are a bit more, at least more cautious when it comes to that. Because whatever the teacher said,
They take it by the book.
Yes, they'll do according to what the teacher said. Even if you sit down with the kid and tell the kid, this is not the way you're supposed to wear that mask. This is not the way you're supposed to do this. Kid,
teacher said
that I'm supposed to do this. Teacher said. So for the kid, at least because they follow the rules. No, for a kid, it's more easier. Even if you want to do something in your house and you want your kid to follow, just go tell your teacher that mtoto afanye hii, the teacher ukuwa nafanya hii. So automatically the teacher told me right. To be doing this and this. Okay. So they are so much obedient to the teachers and hoping the way you said or what Aja said, that the way they used to, they were taught how to wash their hands, even up to today, it is what is happening.
Okay.
So if we, the grown-up, can be like those kids, we can be in the safest place in this Nairobi mm-hmm. and in this Kenya.
Nice. So I'd just like you guys to give last remarks in less than 30 seconds. What's your idea of the new normal? What is it that we should embrace? What is it that we should let go? Yes, Angela.
I think we need to ask to embrace the fact that there is nothing much we can change about what is going on. That is, the pandemic is here, and we just have to learn to live with it. And again, we don't need to really blow it so much, because when you consider COVID and things like malaria kills more people than COVID has. So we have been driven by fear so much. It's good to protect ourselves, but let us not be driven so much by fear, because you realize that even I have a doctor friend who tells me that those people in the hospitals, most of them who are admitted, it's because of what is going on in their heads. Mm-hmm. It's not because of really what they are ailing from.
Okay.
If they could change their mindset, they could just be discharged and go home.
Okay.
Yeah. So yes. It's all about our mindset.
Yes, Mwangi?
On my side, my biggest idea would be let people first learn to adapt very easily when something happens. Because at the time we blame the government, we blame other people because of something which is happening, but it's good we train ourselves to adapt.
Okay.
When things happen, such things happen. And also let us open our mind so that we can be focused on, if something like this happens, what can I do? If I lose my job, what can I do? It is good always to be sharp.
Okay.
And let's focus, keep social distance, and at least sanitize, and make sure you're following the COVID-19 rules.
Very well put. Peterson Mwangi, who is an insurance manager, and Angela Nzinani, a life coach. That is where we conclude our discussion today of the big idea. What is your new normal? Let us keep the conversation going at Look Up TV on Twitter, Look Up TV on Facebook, and using the SMS number 20374. I am Nancy Nalima. Thank you so much for watching.
We value your feedback and welcome your complaints about our programming and operations. Feel free to get in touch with us through 0700 893